Hello, I'm David Lloyd. As we celebrate the 50th anniversary of BBC local radio across all 40 stations, I've been hearing from some of its pioneers and listening to some of its earliest programmes. In the next hour, the story of how and why the BBC went local in 1967.
This is BBC Radio Leicester.
This is the first hometown radio station in Britain.
Hello, BBC Radio Brighton. Can I help you?
You're tuned to Radio Nottingham, VHF 94.8 and Rediffusion Channel C's, Greg Say.
The new MI will create new jobs for about 300 people in the Kiverton Park area. Sorry, that should have read the new M1.
When we looked at the problem of bringing its own radio to Leeds, we thought a little buffoonery was the answer. But it's buffoonery with a ruthless purpose, survival.
They were playing A Whiter Shade of Pale, and I've always loved that song ever since. There I was. Gosh, this is really the BBC.
What I hoped for was something conversational and free-flowing, friendly radio.
Friendly radio, that's how the founding father of BBC Local Radio, Frank Gillard, described his vision. It was for a network of stations which would bring the expertise of the world's greatest broadcaster to serve the diverse communities of Britain in the 1960s. Dr. Matthew Linfoot of the University of Westminster has made a study of BBC Local Radio's early years, a time of upheaval in politics, music and media.
The times they are changing.
One area was the way that society and culture generally became more interested in looking at the diversity of life. This was the era of kitchen sink dramas.
They never know when they're past it, do they, Mrs. Hardy?
So it was more to do with people's stories that weren't so dominated by drawing room dramas or, you know, the upper classes. It was more to do with ordinary people.
We're off to Blackpool this weekend.
Well, I'm coming with you this time.
There was also a perception that people weren't that involved with the democratic process, that local democracy wasn't really being engaged with.
Eric Reginald Lubbock, 22,000...
The first senior manager in the BBC to make the argument for local radio was the head of the West Region, Frank Gillard. He'd been a household name as a war reporter in the 1940s.
Hello, BBC, this is Frank Gillard here, recording just outside Chile, mile or two back from Chile, on Friday morning, June the 16th, during a barrage which is being laid down to prepare the way for an infantry attack.
Frank Gillard was a school teacher originally from the West Country, and he was taken on by the West Region as a talks assistant in 1941, and he rose through the BBC's ranks through the 1950s.
Back in the early 1950s, on a visit to the United States, I judged that while the BBC had little to learn from network radio systems over there, the little local stations, which existed in every town and city, were providing a much-appreciated public service which up to then was lacking in Britain.
This is Frank Gillard talking in 1992.
Now, the BBC had shown its value as a national instrument, and this was surely the time to prove that it could provide a corresponding service at the local level and make a substantial contribution to the enrichment of local life.
The BBC also had a very metropolitan focus. You could hear whispers in the press and elsewhere that it was too dominated by a metropolitan outlook.
What I hoped for was something warmer and more accessible. Broadcasters would become almost personal friends.
One of the problems that Frank Gillard encountered in trying to sell the idea of local radio was it didn't exist. So nobody really knew what it sounded like. And from the late 50s onwards, he was continually pestering and putting forward this idea, can we have some experiments? Can we try this out? And the post office, who were in charge of licensing radio for everybody at that time, kept saying no.
Frank Gillard's opportunity came in 1961 when the government established a committee under Sir Harry Pilkington to look into the future of British broadcasting. They need to be persuaded that local broadcasting was a good idea. So to see, or rather hear, what BBC local radio might sound like, 16 closed-circuit stations were established around the country to make programmes that no one except the Pilkington Committee was meant to listen to. Here's Michael Barrett, later the presenter of BBC TV's Nationwide, on the experimental station in Stoke.
Well, it looks like being a busy weekend for clergy and laity alike, with quite a variety of bazaars, anniversaries, opening ceremonies and the like in churches all over the Six Towns area.
And here's Sheila Bailey on the secret station, Radio Norwich.
Molly, do you think people from other parts, especially thickly populated industrial areas, tend to look on Norwich people as rural dolts?
Oh, they do. And they're always complaining because we're flat and uninteresting.
I don't want the hills and I don't want the mountains. I just want friendliness.
Friendly, there's that word again. Paul Hayes from present-day BBC Radio Norfolk has been researching its friendly predecessor.
Norwich was the third one. They'd been two before that in Bristol and in Portsmouth. It was on the 20th of June 1961, and a group of staff came over from Birmingham from the Midland Home Service to come to the BBC outpost that did exist already in Norwich at the time to prepare and produce this day of broadcasting.
What price are strawberries?
Well, I should imagine the best will be sold at 1/6 to 1/8, but anybody that wishes to make jam, they can buy jam strawberries about 1/3 to 1/4.
I talked to the Mayor of Durham, Councillor Williamson, who, as you know, is also a butcher. And this week, he recommends all English meats.
Radio Hull, your local BBC station. The time? 6 o'clock. Well, good morning. It's Michael Barton here in the Guildhall on a rather uncertain morning.
Michael Barton, who'd later become the controller of local radio, was working for the BBC in Manchester.
I was asked to go to Hull, which is my old hometown, to do an experiment there. Others were taking place in Durham and Poole.
This is your local BBC station serving Bournemouth, Christchurch and Poole.
Some results from the East Dorset Croquet Club's annual tournament at Parkston.
What Frank was doing, very cleverly, was building up his little archive, which was going to be used in the future to persuade the doubters, the politicians, those with influence, that this is the way forward.
The chief instructor from the staff training department was present at the Norwich pilot. It's a chap called Elwin Evans, and he says, all the presentation, interviewing and commentary work at Norwich was done by three studio managers, and the enthusiasm with which they seized their opportunities was most exciting.
Canon Creed Meredith beat Major Hill Bernard, retired hurt.
When the Pilkington Committee reported in 1962, it was clear that Frank Gillard had scored a big win. The BBC was encouraged to move into local broadcasting, and the very thought of commercial radio in the UK was dismissed out of hand. Newly promoted to director of all BBC radio in 1964, Frank Gillard must have thought his dream was about to be realised. But no, we'll pick up the story after the Rolling Stones. By 1964, as the new beat groups like the Rolling Stones and the Beatles were dominating the pop charts, the great advocate of local stations, Frank Gillard, had become director of all BBC radio. But in the corridors of power at the BBC, there was a major distraction.
This is Simon D talking to you on behalf of all of us on Radio Caroline, here 4.5 miles away from Felixstowe.
The pirate radio ships had sailed onto the medium wave and were proving a huge demand for round-the-clock pop radio, which the BBC couldn't satisfy with a few shows here and there on the light programme. But they were petrified by the potential challenge of radio with adverts.
Light up the Richmond, strike it rich.
Richest flavour yet in a tipped cigarette.
Light up a Richmond, strike it rich with Richmond.
Just 4 and 3 for 20.
After years of wrangling with Harold Wilson's Labour government, Frank Gillard finally got his way. Just before Christmas in 1966, a white paper on broadcasting announced the BBC would launch a new national pop service to replace the pirates, and what was called an experiment in local radio.
When you look at the correspondence, the memos and the archive reports, you'll see that the BBC were very aware that there was the potential for commercial radio.
Matthew Limfoot.
It was clear that commercial radio could fill a gap by providing local news, local information. And that was something that Frank Gillard was very clear that he wanted the BBC to do first.
And so, in January 1967, before the locations of the new services had been decided, job adverts began to appear.
Station managers, salary £3,300.
He?
Note the implication that in the 1960s this wasn't considered to be a job for a woman.
Will be required to weld staff into a vigorous team, capable of providing a local service in a lively form.
At the same time, the BBC needed some people who could use a soldering iron.
Station engineer. The holder will maintain a VHF transmitter, two studios, recording equipment and mobile outside broadcast unit.
The BBC had its plans for local radio in their back pocket right through these years. Frank Gillard had constantly been honing and redefining what local radio would sound like and how it would work. So by 1966, he was able to produce his plans and say, OK, if we're going to go through with reorganising the networks and having a pop music station, let's do local radio at the same time.
But where would these new stations be based and who'd pay for them?
The government had said there would be no increase in the licence fee. So Gillard and the BBC came up with the idea that local authorities would contribute to the running of the local stations. So the BBC entered into a sort of bidding process. It began in 1967 in January with a meeting at Broadcasting House where they entertained representatives from about 200 local authorities and borough councils. And they tried to sell to them the idea of local radio. And they encouraged them to put forward offers.
I was lucky enough to be there to see Frank, a single figure on stage, talking to these people about the power of local radio. Now, that's a big ask to say, here, if you want a radio station, we'll give you the gear, but of course, it'll cost you. So, by the time he'd finished playing his clips, which he'd made from these experiments around the country, they were queuing up to eat out of his hand.
Of the 83 expressions of interest, the majority came from the north of the country. Very few came from the south. One of the early front runners was Manchester. Now, Manchester City Council had a plan actually to create their own local station before the local radio experiment. So Gillard put them quite high on the list because he felt that they'd done quite a lot of the groundwork and they were really keen on the idea. Other places who came through very early on were Norwich, Stoke, Hull, Bristol. These were all the early favourites, but they would only get a station if they actually came up with some cash.
The first stations announced were Leicester, Merseyside and Sheffield. Six more were promised as negotiations continued. Meanwhile, during that summer of love in 1967, the newly appointed station managers were recruiting their teams. We'll meet some of the surviving pioneers after this from that summer of love and local radio. If you're going... In the late summer of 1967, whilst Scott McKenzie was going to San Francisco, the first recruits to BBC local radio were assembling in London. Just across the road from the BBC's Grand Imperial Broadcasting House is an impressive 19th century building called the Langham. Nowadays, it's a very swanky hotel. But for a few years after the Second World War, it was used by the BBC as an annex to Broadcasting House. And that's where Frank Gillard established his new local radio headquarters. A handful of senior managers, all shown in photographs from the time wearing suits and ties, began the job of recruiting the production and engineering staff who'd run the new stations. Owen Bentley had been working for the BBC in Africa.
I saw the ad. It must have been an aerial, the BBC staff magazine.
Programme assistant. The postholder is responsible for manning the control panel in the studio and making the necessary bridging announcements.
I was working at BBC Norwich in East Anglia, and I was officially a secretary there. And the engineers said, you ought to go in for that, Gina. You're always talking.
I was advised to apply for two jobs. One was assistant engineer and the other was general station assistant. And that's the job I got.
Gina Madgett and Dave Wilkinson, both part of Radio Nottingham's launch team. Recruitment continued as more locations were confirmed and staff were invited to apply for specific stations. Owen Bentley.
To be perfectly and absolutely honest with you, I applied for Stoke because I thought it would be the easiest one to get into, because I thought there wouldn't be a mammoth amount of people going from London for this particular job.
I was interviewed by a number of people. Was I interested in Sheffield? Did I want to go to Stoke? Did I want to go to Nottingham? All these options were available.
I chose Brighton because I'd been a television reporter working out of Southampton.
And I thought, despite my age, which was 23, but I added a couple of years on for the purpose of the job or getting the job, I never expected to get it.
I was basically working in advertising on the Liverpool Echo, which was the local paper. And I saw this ad for a secretary for the news station. I'd always wanted to get into journalism, and I thought this is a really good way of getting in. I applied for the job, and I said that I'm messy, slightly disorganised. I can type, and I can do shorthand, and I'm enthusiastic.
Wendy Lloyd, now Bennett, David Wayne, Bob McLeish and Owen Bentley, all founder members of the local radio family and all going strong today as well. Now the hard work began.
The training at the Langham, which of course is now the Hilton, it was a wonderful old place full of stories about ghosts overnight. And you'd get all these decrepit engineers who'd say, now this is an apple and biscuit microphone. And you'd think, yes, what do I do with that?
The Radio Brighton training scheme that we went on was, if my memory serves me correctly, 5 weeks long. And we all met there, some people not knowing anything at all about radio. I mean, they'd come from completely different walks of life. And they were a motley crew on the face of it.
You were taught so many technical things, most of which, as other members of staff of my station at the time will recognise, I never quite caught on to.
There was a senior lecturer who was of more the old school, the Radio 3 kind of approach to speech radio. And he used to get people to read things and then perform them. And he'd stop them at the end of a sentence and say, no, give it air, dear boy, give it air.
One day, a guy came along who was training us to read the news, although I personally was not going to read the news at that stage, but we all had to go into the cubicle on our own. Everybody else was outside, but in rows of chairs, and they could hear what was going on. And you had to pick up your piece of paper and read this news. And I'd never done anything like that before. And I came out, and this chap, who should be nameless, mainly because I've forgotten his name, he said to me, well, you'll never make a broadcaster. Oh.
Jenny Collins, now Jenny Vose, went on to work for Radio Merseyside for 28 years. The big challenge for the new recruits was that everyone would have to learn how to put their station on air and run a studio on their own.
We were being told that we're going to go there, the equipment is purpose-built, and if we've got long enough arms, one arm on one end of the desk that we operated and one on the other, we're going to be able to do the whole lot ourselves. And the chap sitting next to me, who was a Radio Brighton recruit, nudged me and said, I wonder what we're going to do in our spare time then.
It was a real grounding in the technicalities of radio, when actually what we needed was, how do you speak, how do you put telephones on air, and how do you put records on air?
It was extremely exciting because most of the people that they picked for these jobs had not previously had broadcasting experience. I think that was a good move because they brought people in, particularly at Radio Merseyside, some of whom had worked in the BBC before. They took over the management roles, but everybody else was completely new. And that had a good fresh feel to it because it was the middle of the 60s and something was coming along that was really fresh and not the same old BBC sitting there reading the news in a dinner jacket.
The BBC managers and the local councils were competing to become the first station on air. And in July 1967, somewhat lost in the media hubbub around the launch of radios 1, 2, 3 and 4, it was announced that the first BBC local station would be in the East Midlands. Radio historian Matthew Limfoot.
Leicester came up with not only the annual running costs, they were also willing to pay the capital setup costs. Also, the mayor of Leicester was Sir Mark Hennig, the chair of the Association of Municipal Councils. So there was a little bit of buddyism going on there. And it was obvious that they were really keen to get a station, so they probably had the advantage.
We should be on the air about 17 or 18 hours a day, and about 4 hours of the 17 will be local output.
Radio Leicester's station manager, Maurice Ennals, in July 67.
The whole idea of local radio, or certainly here in Leicester, is that we will try and give most of the people, most of the time, most of the national programmes that they want. We shall be carrying The Dales, The Archers, World at One, Family Choice, Swing Along. We will be carrying these, but then there will be the dividend on 95.05 of getting their local output.
4 hours a day? It wasn't really that different from the BBC's pre-war stations with names like 2ZY and 5IT, which had carried programmes from London interspersed with local output. And a rather sceptical BBC Home Service reporter raised the other elephant in the room.
Now, you gave me a number, a figure just now. I don't know what it means. Is this where we find you on the dial?
95.05 VHF.
And you're dependent entirely on VHF?
Yes, we are. It's estimated by the BBC that about one home in every three has a VHF set. Now, this is applied to Leicester. This means that there is a potential audience of about 90,000, plus 20 or 30,000, which we'll get over the wired services.
By wired services, Maurice Ennals meant the cable system operated by Rediffusion, which brought what was usually called piped TV and radio into offices and homes. Apart from that, the new stations would be wholly dependent on VHF, or what we now call FM. Feverish activity continued throughout October. We'll hear how the first BBC local station sounded after this, a hit in the same week for the Kinks. On Wednesday, November the 8th, 1967, the studio clock ticked round to 12:45, and a tape machine clunked into action to herald the start of what was still known as the BBC's local radio experiment.
This is BBC Radio Leicester. Good afternoon from Radio Leicester, broadcasting on 95.05 VHF. Here is the Postmaster General, the Right Honourable Edward Short.
This is the first hometown radio station in Britain. It opens a new and, I think, exciting chapter in the story of British radio.
I believe that local radio is catching on very fast in Leicester. I believe that it's a wonderful project, and already we can see the women in Leicester beginning to look in the shop windows and wonder if they're going to have VHF and whether they can get up in the morning and listen to what's going on in Leicester and begin to feel proud of the city and its achievements.
I'm looking forward to a great deal more than what I've heard already on Radio Leicester today, and I'm certain it's going to be an exciting project. It certainly is going to catch on very, very quickly indeed.
It's music through to 10 o'clock on Radio Leicester.
I'm afraid I don't know about Radio Leicester very much at the moment, but I'm hoping to get a radio as soon as possible.
I wouldn't know how to get Radio Leicester. I wouldn't, that's true.
Yes, I have heard of Radio Leicester, and I will be listening in as a neighbour to see if I like it, and if so, I'll buy a VHF set.
All the new stations were offered the services of the BBC's Radiophonic Workshop, which at the time was best known for this. Michael Barton, busy preparing his team for the launch of the second station, Radio Sheffield, came up with what we might now call a creative concept.
I thought, well, Sheffield, City of Steel, Cutlery, I wonder if Delia Derbyshire, who was then running the Radiophonic Workshop in London, would be able to do something with a knife, fork and spoon. And of course it was an amazing piece of work. I mean, it was not the most memorable tune.
This is BBC Radio Sheffield on 88.6 VHF. Good morning. My name's Jack Thompson. The day, Wednesday, November the 15th, 1967. The time, 1 minute to six. Well, it is according to my studio clock here at number 60 Westbourne Road.
Early transmissions from Radio Sheffield weren't without their mishaps.
The new MI will create new jobs for about 300 people in the Kiverton Park area. Sorry, that should have read the new M1.
But like Leicester, Sheffield soon established itself at the centre of its community as a place to call in an emergency. Like, for instance, when you're stuck in a wardrobe.
Yes, the wardrobe has got four hooks on it. Yeah. And the hooks have got onto the banister. And I just can't move.
How can you get to the telephone?
Well, we've a long extension and my wife handed it up to me.
I say to your wife, I'm sorry, Mr. Savage.
She can't help me.
Yeah, next up, as the BBC rolled out its local services, was Liverpool.
This
is Tony Wolf on a test transmission for BBC Radio Merseyside, which opens on the 22nd of this month.
It's a measure of the BBC's achievement in 1967 that it was launching local radio into the teeth of an economic hurricane. Money was too tight to mention, and getting tighter.
From now on, the pound abroad is worth 14% or so less in terms of other currencies. That doesn't mean, of course, that the pound here in Britain, in your pocket or purse or in your bank, has been devalued.
Whilst Merseyside MP Harold Wilson was running the country, Michael Hancock was running the new station.
Well, it's not my running Radio Merseyside, it's Merseyside speaking to itself. And so when I go there with a team of people, and it's Merseyside who we will look to contribute, to talk about its community. It's a community talking to itself, so we're all going to run it.
Radio Merseyside, Radio Merseyside. It's the show local station, the biggest in the land, and it's Merseyside, 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 all the way through.
This is BBC Radio Merseyside.
The idea of this programme was land, sea and air.
Station assistant Jenny Collins, now Jenny Vos.
And we had our producer, Jerry Harrison. He was up at the top of the St John's Beacon, which is a very tall tower here in Liverpool.
I'm sorry, we can't go to the beacon where Jerry Harrison should be, so on we go now to the second Mersey Tunnel.
I was with Victor Marmion. It was dark, it was muddy, it was cold. I mean, this is November, remember? My hands were shaking so much. I was so cold and I was holding onto this fader and it wouldn't open it. I mean, my head wouldn't open it, my mind wouldn't open it. And just the first few seconds of what Victor said was never heard.
Marmion, standing at the excavations for the second Mersey Tunnel in Wallasey. We're about a quarter of a mile inland here from Seacombe Ferry.
But we wonder where Jerry Harrison is. Let's call him up again. Come in, Jerry.
360 feet above the centre of Liverpool. And I know Jerry said to me, he said, I think that set the tone for the future. Aim for the top, prepare for disaster. If it goes wrong, keep smiling.
And at least you could be reasonably sure that very few people would have noticed.
No, the big problem was that nobody had FM radios, VHF.
Wendy Bennett, then Wendy Lloyd, was a secretary at the fledgling Radio Merseyside.
There was, at the time, a very well-known sculptor called Arthur Dooley. And Arthur's line was always that more people were interviewed on Radio Merseyside than actually listened to it. And actually, he did have a point.
The pioneers of local radio were hoping that stockings would be piled high with VHF sets at Christmas 67. Three stations were up and running. There should have been a fourth, but as Owen Bentley remembers, preparations for Radio Stoke were suddenly halted.
There came this terrible epidemic of foot and mouth. I mean, there were carcasses burning. There were, oh, horrible thing to remember. Smoke everywhere in the country. And we were due to put up our transmitter in one of those fields.
But there would be one more BBC station before Christmas. David Wayne was with his new colleagues in the Volunteer Pub on the South Coast.
It was December the 8th, and somebody came bursting through the door, and she said, Bob wants you all back immediately. We're going on the air in 3 hours' time.
This is BBC Radio Brighton, on the air for the very first time, over 2 months ahead of our official starting date of February the 14th. And in fact, this is your station manager, Bob Dunnell.
Bob, a local man, had been standing in the only office that was habitable and watching these snowflakes growing ever bigger. And he knew that if this went on, it wouldn't be very long before the coast road was totally cut off.
Two more areas are now completely cut off. We've just heard from East Sussex Police that both Rotting Dean and Salt Dean are completely isolated. They join Newhaven and Seaford, which are also cut off.
And he thought this was a major opportunity, PR opportunity, and to do something really worthwhile for the community.
Police also tell us that literally hundreds of cars have been abandoned along the coast road, and they once again issue this warning that if you're going to abandon your car, lock valuables in the boot.
I was listening to the television and I heard that Radio Brighton had started, so I switched on the radio and I heard, fortunately, that there'd been delays on the line from London to Brighton, and as my husband wasn't home and he's usually home at 6 o'clock in the evening, I didn't have to worry.
I think that Radio Brighton can do
a good job of work in emergencies.
Radio Brighton was the first station to show that local radio's finest hour would often be the result of snow, floods and other natural disasters. Its role in the future of British broadcasting was looking more assured. But as the Beatles embarked on their magical mystery tour, there was still a long way to go. In January 1968, the spotlight turned back to the East Midlands.
This is BBC Radio Nottingham on VHF 94.8 and Rediffusion Channel C. And the chimes of Little John, Nottingham City Clock, signal the fact that Radio Nottingham is officially on the air.
Yes, and another winner from the radiophonic workshop, Robin Hood's Sonic Arrow. Radio Nottingham had learned a thing or two from its predecessors, but it had some innovative ideas of its own. Here's an extract from what's claimed to be the very first time listeners were allowed to put their questions directly to local officials and councillors.
I have offered to Mr. Goslin and to Mrs. Smith and to the Ratepayers Association that any time I can be of any service to them, I will be there. And I haven't had any communication from them at all about these rats. So this is a lot of poppycock, this throw.
Can we interrupt you a moment? Because we have a listener on the phone to us all here, and it's Mr. Preston of Woodborough Road. What's your point, Mr. Preston?
Well, just might I say that we have had this problem. We have had rats.
Radio Nottingham's What Are They Up To Now? It has to be said, though, that some of Nottingham's earliest experiments with phone calls are a bit clunky to modern ears.
And within seconds, in fact, we had a telephone call. It's quite fantastic just how quickly some people managed to ring in. And I'm going to talk to the person who rang in right now. And what is your name?
Colin Sampson.
And what do you reckon it is, Colin?
National Anthem of Belgium.
Sorry, Colin, you're not right. In fact, it's... Well, I won't tell you what it is, will I? Because we have some more telephone calls.
Yeah.
Whereabouts are you ringing from?
From my home.
Tony Cook on Radio Nottingham in 1968. From the same year, here's Tony Church with Squeg the Squirrel, who was invented to cover up occasional technical difficulties.
You're tuned to Radio Nottingham, VHF 94.8 and... Rediffusion Channel C, is Greg saying. It's about the only thing he can say these days because he disgraced himself so much last week when he got all the things wrong and got his tail on the records and things like that, that really, Greg, I'm surprised you're speaking at all.
Well, Nottingham's first programme organiser, Bob McLeish, remembers how this all was perceived by the rest of the BBC.
There was a good deal of disrespect sometimes towards local radio. They looked down on us in a number of ways as toy town radio.
The manager seriously suggesting that I, one of the oldest and the most respectable citizens of Toytown, would care to be seen cutting capers on a stage like a common marionette?
Some of the other newspapers, the national newspapers, did regard us as Toytown radio. I have to confess that if I listened to some of the programmes that went out then, I might colour a little with embarrassment. But even if they didn't work first time round, or even if people sounded amateurish. I knew that time would change all of that, and it did.
Michael Barton, later the controller of BBC Local Radio. Meanwhile, on the South Coast, Radio Brighton made its debut in February 1968. Manager Bob Gunnell had no doubts about its significance.
One of the things that all of us are certain about is that local radio is here to stay. It is, in fact, perhaps the beginning of something very, very big indeed for this country. We're on the verge of what must be a revolution in communication.
Bob Gunnell's number two at Radio Brighton was David Wayne, later head of radio and TV for BBC Midlands.
Bob was an immensely innovative person, and he was also difficult to stop when he was in full flood. And he was absolutely certain that the 24-hour clock would take over and it would just be common parlance in the end. It just wanted somebody to start the ball rolling. I used to present a 15-minute local news programme called At One with Brighton. This is BBC Radio Brighton. And then they'd say, it's 13 hours. Now, At One with Brighton.
Here are some clips from the early days of what we now call BBC Sussex.
Say something to our listeners. You're our first guest of Construction Boys on Radio Brighton.
Well, this is BBC Radio Brighton on 88.1 metres.
Look to your future. In today's programme, we talk about employment in industry,
What's all this social snobbery about factory workers?
That one up in the office. She looks at you as if you were a piece of dirt. I think so, anyway.
But now here's your programme. Right, over to Mike Fanstone for our very first record request.
Good evening, everyone, and our first record request is one that's been requested by lots of people, and it's requested firstly by Pat Blake of Holmbanks, Kingston Lane, Southwick, whose birthday is next week, and it's from John Fred and his Playboy band, and it's called Judy in Disguise. Judy in the sky,
well, that's what you are. Good evening. I want to talk particularly to our senior citizens and other people living alone, and to warn you against some despicable men posing as rating officers, drain inspectors.
Next up, with the foot and mouth outbreak cleared and its transmitter now safely installed, was Radio Stoke. On their opening day, the legendary broadcaster John Snagg remembered 6ST, the pre-war station where his own career had started, after the inevitable radiophonic teacups to celebrate the potteries.
This is BBC Radio Stoke-on-Trent. We must apologise to listeners for the break in transmission, which occurred at 12 o'clock midnight on October the 30th, 1928. This was due to circumstances beyond our control.
What I liked about the early days of local radio was that we were the skeleton.
Owen Bentley, later head of BBC Radio in Birmingham.
And we were there to actually facilitate local people actually getting on air. And so there was endless little training courses we organised for teachers or people who just wanted to actually come in and make programmes.
They tell me there's been a big rush for VHF wireless sets, which proves to me that some people are more interested in Radio Stoke than the Macanite. This time next year, people won't want to listen to anything else but Radio Stoke. It'll be like a drug with them. They won't be able to keep off it.
The story of Esperanto is the classic one, isn't it? Stoke is a hotbed of Esperantism, of the language. I mean, there's Zamenhof Way, there's the Stella Verde pub still there, I think, now. They were really enthusiasts. And this headmaster who ran the group said, I want us to do a soap opera in Esperanto. And so the Esperanto family of Robinson came in.
Dormo tutte finis doloron de la coro. La mil batoin heredon de la corpo.
Whether it was Esperanto programmes or the 24-hour clock or squeaky toys presenting shows, it was clear that local radio was the place to try something different. As we've heard, station managers were encouraged to innovate. Here's how Radio Leeds, the seventh station, launched in June 1968.
The time is 5:30. This is BBC Radio Leeds.
Radio Leeds is a bloody waste of time.
Launching with someone describing your station as a waste of time can only have been the decision of BBC Local Radio's most idiosyncratic manager, Phil Sidey. Here he is in 1968.
When we looked at the problem of bringing its own radio to Leeds, we thought a little buffoonery was the answer. But it's buffoonery with a ruthless purpose, survival. For instance, we have a ludicrously small budget, so when we wanted a piano, we advertised for one under the heading, Have You Something Capable of Giving Pleasure to Millions? We had quite a large number of offers, of pianos, I mean, and when the winning piano came to the studios, it was followed in by a passing pianist who offered his services, so we got him as well. And then our record library isn't as big as the main BBC one, so we thought up Bring a Disc, where you can ask for any record in the whole world as long as you bring it along to the studios yourself so that we can play it.
Gerald Jackson, who's still on air today at Radio Lancashire, was a teenage helper at Radio Leeds.
Because Radio Leeds had an extraordinary manager in Phil Sidey, who was larger than life. He'd been a BBC television producer, but he had so much charisma. It was all based, I think, around him.
Hello, this is Ralph Robinson, your man from Auntie, with the only BBC programme money can buy. You can buy time on OPMCB simply by sending a donation to charity. So send in your requests and your offers of cash. Remember, it's your money we're after. Let's hope we get piles.
The Yorkshire Post, for some reason, didn't want to ever print the words Radio Leeds. So he knew that they published the Greyhound results. And he came up with this wheeze, which you have to admit, even today, is really clever. That if you name a dog Radio Leeds or BBC Radio Leeds, they would have to print it in the results. So we got in the Yorkshire Post, BBC Radio Leeds dog.
Well, hello there. Yes, top of the bill, your weekly roundup of entertainment around Leeds.
Rule Britannia and all that lives again with the opening of Theatre Festival 1968. Having seen the show, we know more about Victoria. But what we really would like to know was how the fight started at the VIP reception afterwards.
Finally, in July 1968, the BBC's eighth station came on air. It would be the last of the experimental operations.
Hello and welcome to BBC Radio Durham, your county radio station on 96.8 VHF.
Frank Gillard had been hoping to launch a station in Manchester, but the local authority there hadn't come up with the necessary funding, so the core team was moved to the northeast. There, they were augmented by some local recruits.
I'm a Geordie from the northeast, or really a Wearsider, to be precise. I never thought the Sunderland Echo would lead to a job, but there was an ad for a new experimental station, Radio Durham, so I applied.
From local radio to distinguished war correspondent, Kate Adie's career would move in the opposite direction to Frank Gillard's, but it didn't get off to the most auspicious start.
It was chaos. Very few of us knew exactly what we were doing. The station manager came from Manchester, which is what the station was meant to be. He hadn't a clue about the northeast. And we were in, not the centre of Durham City, which is small anyway, but in a field 2 miles outside, in an old country house. On the first day, we were meant to report there, the staff couldn't find it.
Variety is the essence of Bird's Eye View, from food to fashion, from housekeeping to keep fit. There'll be something for everybody. And helping it along, there'll be a little music.
We haven't talked much about music in this programme because, well, there wasn't much on those early stations. Gerald Jackson again.
We didn't have a massive record library. It was in the ops room, which was a control room for Studio One. And from what I remember, you just basically took the ones off the shelves you fancied. But there was a limit on how much we could play anyway. BBC Local Radio, when it started, was limited to an hour a day of what was called needle time, commercial discs. So I did a programme for a while in the afternoon called Say It With Music, but I wasn't allowed to play music. I had to play what they called library music. Reg Owen and his Big Eight were very fun. BBC bought quite a lot of stuff off the shelf. One was the Canadian Talent Library, which was set up to promote Canadian artists.
In the early morning rain, with no place to go.
Gordon Lightfoot was on the Canadian Talent Library and many others. And we could play as much of that as we wanted. So, for some odd reason, thus, BBC Local Radio seemed to love Canadian music. There was no music policy as such.
There's one more ingredient in those early schedules we haven't mentioned. We'll come on to that and also find out what happened to the first eight local stations after this, a hit in the summer of 68.
I see trees of green.
Louis Armstrong, a familiar tune on BBC Local Radio throughout its half century. News is now local radio's central purpose. The stations are run by BBC News, not by BBC Radio. And if you visit a local station in the 21st century, you won't find a production office cluttered with records and tape machines. You'll find a modern multimedia newsroom, often shared with regional television and BBC Online. But in the late 60s, there were no BBC local radio journalists. The news was bought in from local agencies whose main business was supplying newspapers.
It wasn't a very good idea because the news was written by people who wrote for newspapers and it wasn't well written for radio.
Tony Cook, production assistant and later news editor at Radio Nottingham.
And I suggested, why can't we do this on our own? And why can't we recruit the two main writers from the news agency? So I was given the go-ahead to set up the first self-contained newsroom in local radio. I actually tell a slight lie. It wasn't the first. Leeds was, because they couldn't get an agency to provide their news. And they did have their own journalists. But I was the first official news editor in local radio. And in fact, I went to a local fruiterer's and got one of their vegetable racks. And that was used as the raw copy tray, the finished copy tray, and so on.
As the experimental period came to an end, all eyes were on the post office, who managed the UK airwaves and who would decide local radio's future. There was a lot of nervousness as they canvassed opinions from listeners.
There were thousands of respondents.
Dr. Matthew Linfoot.
Over 95% of these were favourable to local radio. And the post office produced its report, which suggested that it should be allowed to continue. However, how was it going to be paid for? Now, the Labour government, Harold Wilson and the BBC were locked in a period of negotiation, frantic to-ing and fro-ing over, on the one hand, the BBC is going to have to cut its costs. It might be given a licence fee increase, but was that enough to carry on with local radio?
Staff at the experimental stations held their breath. Suddenly, local radio might be axed to pay for the corporation's regional orchestras.
The deal that Harold Wilson eventually struck with the BBC was to increase the licence fee, provided they saved the orchestras, and at the same time, they were allowed to continue with local radio.
So the BBC had permission to go ahead with a further 20 stations, all of which would have their own newsrooms, and the local authority funding would be phased out. There were still some hurdles to jump, especially when the new Conservative government arrived in 1970 and put the whole issue on hold whilst it considered its plans for a series of commercial local stations. But the healthy infant was well on its way to maturity and to the network of stations across England and the Channel Islands which we know today.
When you look at the archives and read up about the first eight stations, there was definitely an era of pioneering. They were inventing this whole idea of what local radio actually meant.
It wasn't the BBC saying, this is what we're going to do for you. It was the BBC saying, what can you do for yourselves?
It's what Phil Sidey at Leeds called walk-in and talk radio.
I think local radio, BBC local radio, was a sort of quiet revolution in broadcasting, actually.
Frank Gillard left the BBC by 1970, 71, and he was writing in The Listener, reflecting on the state of local radio as it was growing and lamenting the fact that it still hadn't quite captured that sense of participation with the local community.
In the beginning, I hoped we'd have 60 stations. The BBC found it impossible to put a local radio station in every town. The cost was too high. So it had to compromise by making one station serve several adjoining communities. This has diluted the original principle, and BBC local radio is not as community-based as I'd originally hoped.
There was an absolutely clear view. We will be staffed by the community, for the community, and what they put into it, they will get out of it. If you like, in more modern parlance, we will be enablers.
One thing all our pioneers share is a pride in their achievements 50 years ago. Will the BBC stations, including this one, be around for another 50 years? Well, if they can harness the energy and creativity of the first eight, the answer will be a resounding yes. So here's to BBC Local Radio's 50th birthday and many more. A final word from Gerald Jackson.
It was the fact that we came out to the regions and into the towns and cities that gave people like me a chance to get into radio. And if you want to find where people are coming into broadcasting, it's in local radio. Whilst we've been sitting in this studio chatting, a lot of younger people have walked past, and they're people who've came here on work experience and now have got shifts here and are beginning to work in programmes. So that's still supporting the community. And having a quarter of a million people listening to a local radio station is a sizeable number of people.
Friendly Radio was a TDC production for BBC English Regions. Our thanks to everyone who shared their stories and found the archive clips. I'm David Lloyd. Research was by Emma Casson, and the producer was Trevor Dann.